Around 4,000 years ago, long before Al-Khwarizmi's algebra, way before Euclid's geometry, and a little after your mom, the ancient Egyptians were doing things that we still can't fully account for to this day. They're solving problems that were leaps ahead of anything they should be doing. Problems that up until recently we thought could only be done with the tools of modern mathematics. That is, until we discovered the Moscow Papyrus. In the early 1890s, a Russian archaeologist named Vladimir Golenishchev goes to Egypt where he makes a remarkable discovery. You can just buy artifacts, apparently? Indiana Jones is just like poor, I think? I don't know. Point is, Golenishchev whips out his wallet, where he buys several papyruses from one Abdel Razul. Unbeknownst to Abdel Razul, and soon to be beknownst to Golenishchev, is that among these papyruses is a document containing a literal archive of ancient Egyptian mathematical knowledge, preserved for thousands of years, and brought back to Russia to be known as the Moscow Papyrus. And just the look at this thing is crazy. It's only 3 inches wide, but it's 18 feet long and contains 25 ancient mathematical practice problems with their solutions. Today, we literally think it was most likely basically an ancient Egyptian version of a textbook used to train scribes who couldn't get the PDF online for free. And nestled neatly, unassumingly, in the middle of these practice problems is the problem that changed our conception of what the ancient Egyptians were capable of. Problem number 14. And this really does look innocent, because all it asks is, given a truncated pyramid, which is just a regular pyramid with the top cut off, with a base width of 4, a top width of 2, and a height of 6, what is the volume of this shape? Well, according to the provided solutions, you can calculate the volume just by taking 1/3 of 6, then multiplying that by 2 times itself, plus 2 times 4, plus 4 times itself, which is 56, and that's completely right. It also indicates, though, that the ancient Egyptians were aware of the same formula we are for the volume of a truncated pyramid, that being 1/3 times h times a squared plus ab plus b squared. And that in and of itself is pretty neat, but people don't fill books with things that are just neat, except maybe Marie Kondo. But in this case, the fascination with problem number 14 isn't that the ancient Egyptians knew the formula, it's how. How did they possibly figure out the formula for a truncated pyramid? And this might not seem like a worthwhile question, because to the modern mathematician, figuring out this volume is actually really simple. You can pause the video here if you want to try to figure it out yourself, or we can race. Because see, all you have to really do is imagine adding a tip to this truncated pyramid to form a full pyramid. Then we can notice that this new tip here and the full shape are both just regular pyramids, which we know the ancient Egyptians knew the volume of. It's just 1/3 times its height times its base squared. So the volume of a truncated pyramid is the volume of the big pyramid minus the volume of the little pyramid. And then we can do some similar triangle calculations to get the heights here, plug that into our formula, and we can find the volume of the truncated pyramid like so. Which is a perfectly fine answer, but of course we can make it look a little neater, because we can rewrite it like this, and then factor a little bit, do a little bit of canceling, and we get the volume of a truncated pyramid is 1/3 times h times a squared plus ab plus b squared, just like the Egyptians said. However, there's only one problem with this. The ancient Egyptians did not have algebra. See, to everybody else in the world, algebra invokes this idea of solving for x, but to us mathematicians, it's even simpler than that. Algebra is just the study of mathematical expressions, or what you could call forms of calculations. So for example, if you want to do something like find the formula of, I don't know, just a truncated pyramid you could do, all you're really doing is writing down the form of the calculation you need to perform on the relevant parameters, here, the base width, the top width, and the height, that would get you the volume you're after. Now, you're not actually putting quantities into that calculation, because the exact lengths will change based on the truncated pyramid you're looking at. So you put in variables instead, since those quantities may vary. Now, very importantly, even though for each truncated pyramid, this calculation will have different quantities plugged in, the form of the calculation will remain the same. But the ancient Egyptians did not roll this way. In fact, they didn't roll any way at all, because this is before they discovered the wheel, but it's also before they discovered the variable. There's one reason why that even in their textbook here, when they're trying to communicate the formula for the volume of a truncated pyramid, they use a specific example to do it rather than just writing down the formula like we would today. Because how would you write down a general formula without a variable? The trouble is, though, if you don't have a way to write down the forms of calculations, it's incredibly hard to figure out which forms of calculations are actually doing the same thing. For example, from high school algebra, we know that doing the calculation x squared minus y squared is actually the exact same thing as doing the calculation x minus y times x plus y. These are called algebraic identities, and there are a ton of them. Now, the ancient Egyptians were certainly aware of simple versions of this, like the fact that x plus y equals y plus x, but based on all other sources we have, the ancient Egyptians were completely unaware of more complicated algebraic identities, like the difference of cubes law we use here. We just don't ever see them use this to solve problems, and they didn't even really encounter problems that required them to think this way. And the reason I care about these algebraic identities is because they're the way that we rewrite expressions to look neater. So if we go back to our work, it's conceivable the ancient Egyptians maybe could get to this step here, but in these last few steps where we use the difference of cubes law and other identities to rewrite it in a neater way would be completely inaccessible to them. So if they wrote their formula this way, there'd be no mystery at all. We could see exactly how they get this formula, and I could sleep at night the rest of you sheep. But the problem is they didn't. They specifically wrote it in this other, neater way that seems like it would require algebra they just did not have. So how? How did the ancient Egyptians get this formula? Now at this point, I think it's a good idea to go back and try a simpler problem. That's always a good problem-solving technique. And the simpler problem in this case is find the volume of a regular pyramid. How'd the Egyptians ever know that? Well, there are a lot of theories, but most people think they basically just guessed and checked. For example, you can take a hollow pyramid and fill it with sand, and then pour that into a rectangular prism with the same base and height. And you notice the sand takes up about one-third the box. You could even check that guess by pouring in two more pyramids of sand and finding out that it exactly tops off the box, meaning the box contains three times the volume of one of those pyramids. Or, in a different way, one of those pyramids is one-third the volume of the box, i.e. one-third times the height times the base squared. But the issue in applying this method to the truncated pyramid is that the volume of a truncated pyramid is just way too hard to guess. I mean, you can make a model of a truncated pyramid and fill it with sand and pour it into boxes all day long if you want, but who in their right mind would guess that the level of the sand is exactly going to be one-third times h times this whole long formula? Not me. The smartest guy I know in this room. So if you believe everything I've said so far, which you should, because I've been under mathematical oath this whole time, then we're forced to make a bold conclusion. The ancient Egyptians clearly knew this formula, but they got it from a completely different path than we would ever even consider. And to get some clue as to how, we have to start thinking like they did. So you can loosely think about the history of math as being a sequence of big leaps, where each leap is just a new perspective on how to solve problems that makes a really hard problem really, really easy when you look at it from this new perspective. So for example, one giant leap was when Descartes realized that algebra and geometry were just two sides of the same coin. So if you're trying to solve a really hard algebra problem, you could shift perspective and look at it as geometry and then get it that way. Or vice versa, if you're trying to solve a geometry problem, it's easier to look at it from the algebraic perspective. But back in the ancient Egyptian time, even though they did not have algebraic manipulations or this different perspective shift with algebra and geometry, they did have one great tool at their disposal, dissection. Somebody figured out the simple but really useful and elegant fact that if you break up a shape and rearrange its pieces, you don't change the area of that shape. So for example, if you want to know the area of a trapezoid with top width A, bottom width B, and height H, if you're trying to figure out the formula from scratch, it would be really hard. But if you think about dissecting it into these two pieces and then moving this triangle up and over like this, you see that the area of the trapezoid is actually just the area of this rectangle. And shifting perspective from trying to find the area of the trapezoid to find the area of the rectangle is huge because we know the area of a rectangle. It's just base times height. This tells us the area of a trapezoid is going to be this formula here. So the idea is, what if the ancient Egyptians used this tool of dissection to figure out the volume of the truncated pyramid? What if there's a way to cut up and rearrange a truncated pyramid into a shape whose volume is naturally given by the formula 1/3 times h times a squared plus ab plus b squared, just like the Egyptians found? And here's where the current research ends and the mystery still remains. We just don't know how the Egyptians would have used dissection to solve this problem. There are a lot of theories, but most of them are fairly complicated and at some point involve assuming the ancient Egyptians knew more algebraic or geometric knowledge than they ever wrote down, in the sources we found at least. And without evidence that they knew this knowledge, that leaves a giant hole in the theory that's really begging for a simpler solution the Egyptians could have actually done. And this is where I come in, because I myself, while thinking about this problem, have come up with a method that I think is the simplest and most elegant that I have encountered yet. It does not require the ancient Egyptians to know anything beyond just how to cut up and rearrange a shape and the volume of a regular pyramid. And I'm going to tell you guys now, because I've been dying to tell somebody, and the voices know how to talk, but they just don't know how to listen. Now imagine you're an ancient Egyptian mathematician facing a culture of publisher locus, and you're charged with finding the volume of this truncated pyramid right here. Now the exact dimensions of this pyramid are really not important to this process, so let's just call the bottom width B, the top width A, and the height H. Now of course the ancient Egyptians would not have actually given these lengths variable names, we already talked about this, but they also wouldn't be making YouTube videos, now would they? I do this stuff for you people. If you appreciate what I do for you, smash that like button, it really helps. Now the first thing we're gonna do is make four straight downward incisions right at the edges of the top square. So. Notice this breaks our original truncated pyramid into nine pieces, one core rectangular prism, four wedges, and four corners. Now we can already see that these four wedges will fit on top of each other perfectly if we stack them like this and like this. And further, these four corners can be put together to make its own perfect skinny little pyramid right over here. Now to make things a little neater, I'm gonna move our newly created rectangular prism over here next to its friend, our other newly created rectangular prism, to make one mega rectangular prism on the left side here. Notice the length of this rectangular prism is B minus A and the width is still A. This exactly lines up with our pyramid we just created, which has base B minus A on both of its sides. Now, very importantly, we can leverage the formula we know for a regular pyramid already. The Egyptians knew the volume of a regular pyramid was 1/3 times the height times the base squared, meaning that without changing its volume, we can replace this pyramid with a block of 1/3 the height and the same base. Now to get everything on the same level, we're gonna split both these rectangular prisms into thirds, so everything's gonna be 1/3 h high. And finally, we just have one last thing to do. We just have to take one of these A by B minus A rectangular prisms and move it over to this corner here. Now if we move everything in together all nice and snug, we see this new shape we've created, which has the exact same volume as our original truncated pyramid, remember, has volume 1/3 h times a squared plus a times b plus b squared. Exactly the formula the Egyptians found. No tricks, no extra algebra. We just rearrange the shape and the formula pops out just like that. Is that how they actually did it? I mean, who's actually to say? No one really knows. That was just my idea, but I'm sure there's many other possibilities out there. So I encourage you at home to join our little forensic math history experiment here and try to figure out your own way the ancient Egyptians could have possibly determined the volume of this shape using what they knew. All right, so what did we learn? Me? I learned nothing. I wrote the script. But I hope maybe you all learned how powerful even a simple tool like dissection can be. See, so often in math class, as soon as problems start to get hard, they just teach us the next giant leap in perspective and make them easy to solve again. But that's not how math is actually done. The ancient Egyptians are proof that between these giant perspective leaps, there are a lot of really smart mathematicians working really hard to take the current tools they have to an absolute 11 and able to figure things out that seem beyond the scope of their capabilities. So what problems right now are a little bit of elbow grease and our current tools away from being solved? And which will become immediately easy once we make our next giant leap? Only YouTube math historians 4,000 years from now can tell. So to make sure this channel's around in 4,000 years, you can help by liking and subscribing right now. We really want to grow this channel and reach more people with fascinating math content that I think I would have liked to see coming up, and we can only do that with your help. So like and subscribe and comment what you want to see next. Have a great day, everybody.